Whole Story Audio presents an unabridged recording of Legacy, One Family, A Cup of Tea and the Company That Took on the World by Thomas Harding, narrated by Mark Meadows. Someday, the history of the family ought to be written. When it is written, the author must be allowed to write about us as he or she pleases, without being inhibited by the sort of constraint that I, for one, and I'm sure others also, would want to impose if it were written now. This means that the history will not be written for many years. Geoffrey Salmon, 1974. Prologue. On a clear but cold autumn morning in late September 1906, two very unusual trains were preparing to leave London's Euston Station. The concourse was flooded with smoke, the sounds of men barking orders and guards blowing whistles. One train was steadily filling with almost 1,000 waiters, cooks, superintendents and kitchen assistants, all smartly dressed and chatting excitedly. The other was being loaded with provisions, 25,000 plates, 64,000 knives, forks and spoons, 12,000 glasses, 4,000 serving dishes and 1,000 flower ornament centerpieces, not to mention more than 60 tons of food and drink. A newspaper described this railway convoy as the most curiously laden goods trains that have ever left Euston. The trains made their way north, some 850 kilometres up the British East Coast to Scotland's granite city, Aberdeen. There, the staff and provisions were quickly and skillfully ferried to a giant pavilion erected in the grounds of the University of Aberdeen. The staff marvelled at the structure that had been specially erected. The tall wooden poles festooned with evergreens and roses, illuminated by pearls of gold and pink electric lights. The colourful academic robes that had been brought in from across the United Kingdom and the British Empire. The banquet marked the culmination of a week-long celebration of the university's quadricentennial, which featured honorary degrees being handed to 130 dignitaries, an all-Scottish athletics event, and, most importantly, a visit by King Edward VII and Queen Alexandra. Amongst the banquet's guests were the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Prince of Monaco, the Secretary of State for Scotland, and Andrew Carnegie, the American steel magnate and world's richest man. As the waiters dressed into their sharply creased swallowtails and the chefs sweated over giant vats and boilers, some of the event's 2,500 guests began to arrive. From a balcony at the far end of the pavilion, the 3rd Battalion Gordon Highlanders piped God Save the King and Auld Lang Syne. Then the dinner began. The food was as opulent as the setting. 10 courses in all. To start, Tortue Claire, made from 90 turtles that had journeyed up from London, warmed in giant copper cauldrons set up next to the pavilion. Next came an array of mouth-watering dishes, salmon steak and York ham, braised pigeon and cold quail, beef tongue and asparagus in vinaigrette. Followed by mascotte gâteau filled with praline cream, charlotte russe, a trifle made of sponge cake, Bavarian cream and strawberries, and fresh fruit. All of this was washed down by 2,900 bottles of sherry, champagne, hock, claret, port and liqueurs, along with the smoking of 3,000 cigars and more than twice that number of cigarettes. It was an audacious banquet and the biggest Scotland had ever seen. There was only one firm in the empire that could have pulled off such an extraordinary feast, J. Lyons and Company. By 1906, Lyons was the undisputed king of British catering, a firm that came to represent the very best of Britishness. It was an enterprise that not only provided food and drink to all the grand events, the annual garden parties at Buckingham Palace and the Wimbledon Lawn Tennis Championships, but also supplied millions of families across the empire with affordable and high-quality packets of tea, cartons of coffee, loaves of bread, and an endless supply of Swiss rolls and other sweet delights. Perhaps most famously, Lyons also revolutionised the nation's eating habits with a chain of much-loved tea shops from Glasgow in the north to Bournemouth in the south, which were open and accessible to all and were staffed by a small army of loyal nippies. In 1906, Lyons was thriving. Yet, as the century progressed, the company would occupy a far more important position, creating brands that would become recognisable the world over. Lyons corner houses, Lyons made ice cream, Lyons cakes. They ran a chain of lavish hotels, such as the Cumberland and Regent Palace in London, the Commodore in Paris, the Alpha in Amsterdam, and many others. Their factory produced 1/7 of the bombs dropped by the Allies on Germany during the Second World War. They helped to bring women into the workforce in vast numbers and ensured that their eateries were available to all and excluded none. Lyons would also own a list of mega brands such as Tetley Tea, Baskin Robbins, and Dunkin' Donuts, bringing American tastes to the UK and Europe. They even developed the world's first business computer. Lyons was woven into the fabric of British life, a firm that was a favourite of the royal family and of millions of ordinary Britons. Lyons shaped British taste, and in many ways, over a tumultuous century, Britain itself, although few, if any, of Lyons' many millions of customers knew how the company started. And almost no one now remembers the name of the man who began it all, a Hebrew teacher who escaped persecution in Europe, finding opportunity in the slums of East London, a refugee desperate to better himself in a nation that was not always welcoming to outsiders. I've always been fascinated by my family's past, but for a long time I only really knew about my father's side, the Alexanders. Growing up, I knew that the Alexanders had fled Germany for Britain in the 1930s, forced to start again with nothing. We spent most of our time with my father's family. Theirs was the story I knew best, one of violence and sacrifice, but also one of duty and perseverance and love. Of my mother's side, the Salmons and Glucksteins, however, I knew very little, apart from a few odd names. On a shelf in my parents' living room sat a dark green book that contained my mother's family tree, going back generations. I used to spend hours leafing through its pages, examining its charts, awed by the sheer number of people mentioned, each carefully labelled with a date of birth, a date of marriage, and a date of death. Beneath flowed the names of their children and their children's children, the branches reaching ever wider. The names were strange to me, sounding funny when I read them aloud. Montague, Barnett and Isidore, Helena, Adelheid and Bertha. And at the very top of the family tree was a single name, Lehmann Meyer Gluckstein, born 1787, died 1859. My grandfather's grandfather's grandfather. When I was 9 years old, my mother's father, Sam Salmon, took me out for lunch at the Carvery in Marble Arch. I remember being awed by the plush red velvet chairs, the perfect white linen that covered the tables, and the sparkling chandeliers hanging from the dining room's gold and silver painted ceiling. Around us, men in pleated chef's hats and starched white jackets pushed carts piled high with more food than I'd ever seen. Oval platters of roast lamb, chicken and beef, and later, chocolate gâteau, cheesecake, apple strudel and pear flan. "You can eat as much as you want," my grandfather told me. He owned the restaurant, after all. Recently, I was walking through central London with my teenage daughter, also called Sam. From Buckingham Palace, we strolled through Green Park and then past the Ritz Hotel and the Royal Academy to Piccadilly Circus. I pointed to a tall building that housed a designer furniture store but had once been home to the first Lyons tea shop. "That's where Lyons started," I told my daughter. "Lyons?" she asked. I was surprised that we hadn't talked about this before. "The family company," I said, "on your grandmother's side." I gestured towards some buildings on the other side of Piccadilly Circus. "I think Lyons owned that entire block as well," I told her. "It was for a while the biggest hotel in Europe." She rolled her eyes. We walked up Shaftesbury Avenue and stopped outside an enormous five-storey pink-stoned building that stretched up the street for 100 metres. Above its main entrance was carved the legend Trocadero. Not so long ago, it had been the capital's premier restaurant and retail complex, known for its famous guests, fabulous entertainment and extraordinary food. Now it looked abandoned, its windows covered by plywood, its rooms dark and empty. A tired-looking under-construction sign hung over one of the doors. Lyons had not only owned this building, I explained to Sam, they had built it. Who owns it now? Sam asked. I don't know, I replied. The company sold it when they lost everything. What happened? Sam asked. I wasn't sure, but I realized that I was keen to find out. Legacy is my family's story. It is the story of Lyons, but also the story of the Salmons and the Glucksteins, my grandparents and their ancestors, a family who transformed themselves from penniless immigrants to industrial titans and then to failed entrepreneurs in 5 generations. It is a tale of tragedies, triumphs, loves, losses, and above all else, the loyalty that bound the family together. It is also the story of an astonishing 175 years of British history, during which the nation went from being the global superpower to near bankruptcy. An epoch during which technology moved from horse-drawn carts, salted meat and handwritten ledgers, to aeroplanes, frozen food and computers. An epoch in which ordinary people's lives were transformed and their working patterns, social habits and leisure time became unrecognizable compared to those of their grandparents. An epoch in which women went from being unable to eat in public to winning the right to vote, from being unable to work as waitresses to becoming company executives. An epoch in which immigrants from Ireland, the Caribbean, the Indian subcontinent, Australia and Central Europe made a massive contribution to British culture and economy, a contribution that is fundamental to the world we live in today, but all too rarely acknowledged. To unearth the facts as well as the motivations of my family members and those around them, I've relied on archival records, interviews, articles, photographs, and government reports. One of the benefits of writing about J. Lyons and the family behind it is that they were well chronicled by the press. Such coverage has recently been made easily available thanks to the digitization of regional and national newspapers. Thankfully, too, the Salmons and the Glucksteins were obsessed with telling their own stories through private letters and memoirs, biographies, internal memos, reports, and testimonies. Fearing the disclosure of confidential information, however, they published none of these histories. Until now. For I have been lucky enough to be trusted with the family's archives. One of the challenges of writing about a family spanning almost 2 centuries is that there are hundreds of individuals involved. Clearly, it was not possible to describe them all in one book. To offer a pathway through, I focused on a limited number of characters, hoping that through their stories, affiliations, and conflicts, the larger themes and dramas could be loosened. In this way, I hoped to explain to my daughter what happened to her ancestors, how their business rose to such great heights, how it shaped modern culture, and why it collapsed so quickly, from the heights of the Aberdeen banquet to a few scattered memories in just a few decades. And, ultimately, how the Lyons story echoes that of so many immigrants who arrived on Britain's shores in search of the British dream. First, I had to find out about the man at the top of the family tree, Lehmann Gluckstein. Part 1. Lehmann and Samuel. The strength and unity of the family was at its peak whenever there was danger. Mimi Salmon. Chapter 1. 1808. Everyone knew that Lehmann was clever. By the age of 8, the tall, scrawny boy with almond-shaped eyes could read from the ancient Torah kept in the small synagogue on Wasserpfortstrasse in Jaffa. By 13, he could recite Greek, Latin, and Aramaic. Now that he was 18 years old, he could also speak German, French, Flemish, and English, and was teaching Hebrew to his neighbor's children. His latest interest was poetry, particularly the verse of Alexander Pope. Lehmann's language skills, however, would be of no use this day, as his family had been evicted, and he was helping his parents load a cart with their worldly possessions. Through no fault of his own, he was being forced to leave the town of his birth. With a population of just under 2,500 people, Jaffa was a small walled community 100 kilometres northwest of Bremen and 20 kilometres south of the North Sea. The town had changed hands three times over the previous 20 years, from Prussia's Prince Frederick Augustus von Anhalt-Zerbst to Russia's Catherine the Great, and then in 1807 to France's Emperor Napoleon. Lehmann, his parents and siblings, lived in a tiny two-roomed stone house that backed onto the town wall on Kleine Burgstrasse. One of only 17 Jewish families living in the town, they belonged to an insular but close-knit minority. Before the arrival of the French, anti-Jewish sentiment had never been far from the surface in Jever. To obtain employment and a place to live, Lehmann's father, Meyer, had to pay a monthly protection fee to Prince Frederick Augustus and later to Empress Catherine. In return, Meyer was considered to be a Schutzjude, or a protected Jew. He was allowed to work as a textile merchant, one of the few permitted occupations for Jews, along with moneylending, slaughtering animals, and trade in leather. Forbidden occupations included legal work, politics, and trade in sugar, tea, and coffee. The family had hoped that conditions would improve under the French, for Emperor Napoleon had developed a reputation as a man of religious tolerance. At first, the news had been positive. A decree announced that the much-hated protection fee was outlawed, and then the new French Revolutionary Code, including the free exercise of worship, was extended to the residents of Jever. Lehmann and his family greeted these announcements with celebration. Then a new notice had been pinned to the town hall door. From this point forward, and in an effort at assimilation, family members had to share the same last name. They could no longer simply refer to themselves as being the son of someone, such as Meyer, son of Asher, or Lehmann, son of Meyer. After a long discussion about alternatives, and perhaps hoping for better fortune in the future, the family had chosen the surname Gluckstein, or Lucky Stone. It suggested something alchemic, even hopeful, creating gold out of nothing. The application was submitted to the Jever town clerk, a fee was paid, and the name was approved. The change of name and the other decrees, however, could not help the family's financial problems. Following the recent war against Napoleon, the local economy had collapsed. Even more unluckily for Meyer, cheap clothes were now available from France and the Netherlands. He was bankrupt and was being chased by a long list of creditors. More pressingly, he was behind in his rent to his landlord. Some of his neighbours, who were also in debt, might have tried appealing to their creditors' generous natures and thereby negotiated a payment plan, but these neighbours were not Jewish. A few days earlier, a group of thugs had come to Meyer's door and warned him to be out by the week's end, which is why they were leaving. With their belongings now packed, Lehmann, his parents and siblings started on their way. They pulled the cart along the familiar cobbled streets, past the green metal pump where they had taken their water each day, past the red-bricked Catholic church with its tall steeple, past the synagogue on Wasserpfortstrasse where Lehmann had performed his bar mitzvah, and then up to the 3-meter-high wall at the end of Sankt Annenstrasse. As it was still daylight, the gate was open, and, with a greeting to the guard who knew each of them by name, the small group pushed their way beyond the city wall and headed westwards in search of a new home. Over the next few weeks and months, Lehmann travelled widely through the lush flat lands that make up Friesland. Driven by youthful energy and now unencumbered, his parents and younger siblings having settled with relatives, he attempted to find work. He walked the streets, a clay pipe in his mouth, making inquiries, looking for leads. In Hochseel, a fishing village on the North Sea, he applied for permission to live and conduct business, but was refused after the local community argued that Jews always sell at the lowest price, ruining the market for everyone else, and mislead their customers by selling low-quality goods. When he did manage to obtain a contract to work as a kosher slaughterman in another town, a complaint was made against him, saying that his meat tasted bad because he smoked during the preparation. Lehmann claimed not to know that smoking was illegal, but this made no difference, and he was forced out. Finally, after passing a series of tests, he received a license from the townspeople of Farel. He would now work as a kosher inspector and Hebrew teacher. His employment continued until the political context changed once again. In 1813, following Napoleon's defeat in Russia, French troops withdrew from Friesland, including the towns of Farol and Jever, and Prussian troops took their place. This new reality was made permanent on the 18th of June 1815 with Napoleon's defeat at Waterloo, a week's ride from Jever, by British and Prussian troops. The Napoleonic Code was swiftly rescinded. Jews in Friesland were now forbidden from holding public office, serving in the army, teaching in universities, or even owning property. Within a year, Lehmann saw the first anti-Semitic pamphlets circulating in the marketplace. For the next decade, he found work as an itinerant teacher, travelling from town to town, hoping that the hostile atmosphere would subside as stability returned to the region. When he was not teaching, Lehmann kept to himself. Shy and lacking in confidence, he struggled to make new friends. As for women, he had little contact with them. They sat apart from the men in synagogue, and without family nearby, Lehmann was not introduced to girls of his age. As for his business contacts, his pupils were all boys, and he dealt only with their fathers. In his spare moments, Lehmann wrote Edut Asheret, or Witness to Marriage, a book about Jewish wedding contracts and rituals that was published in 1818. At the time, the ancient myth that Jews used Christian blood in their ceremonies was resurfacing around Europe. One of the most common variations of this so-called blood libel was that Christian blood was applied to the fingers of a Jewish bride to free her from her family. Lehmann's study of wedding rituals proved that this was silliness. Although Edut Asheret had little impact at the time of its publication, it would be relied upon by future scholars. It was uncommon for a Jew to be published at this time, particularly given that Lehmann was not formally educated, but it was far from unique. Other published German Jewish writers included the journalist Ludwig Berner, who edited various liberal newspapers in Frankfurt, and Rahel Lefin Farnhagen, who ran an intellectual salon in Berlin and whose superbly written letters would be published after her death. Perhaps most famous of all was Heinrich Heine, who grew up in the Rhineland and wrote enthusiastically about Napoleon's arrival in Düsseldorf. Shortly after Lehmann published his book, Heine wrote Edon, a poem about Prussia's prejudices against the Jews. A brotherly forbearance has united us for ages. You tolerate my breathing, and I tolerate your rages. Each of these authors felt the weight of growing anti-Jewish sentiment in Prussia. Berner, Farnhagen, and Heine all chose to assimilate to the dominant culture by converting to Christianity. Lehmann, in contrast, was determined to hang on to his Jewish faith. For him, religion was more important than country. In the spring of 1819, now aged 32 and hoping to secure a long-term position, Lehmann travelled to Rheinberg, a small town on the banks of the River Rhine, 320 kilometres south of Jever and 70 kilometres north of Cologne. There he applied for and was awarded the prestigious position of the community's Hebrew and religious teacher, and, as one of the town's most learned scholars, often led the congregation during the Friday evening and Saturday morning services. He moved into a modest room on the second floor of number 55 Rheinstrasse, one of the main streets running into Rheinberg. Each morning he was woken by the squawking of chickens and the smell of ducks from the poultry market set up outside his front door. It was only a 5-minute walk to the town's small synagogue, across the main square and then down Gelderstrasse, and it was here that he gave Hebrew lessons. With only 65 Jewish people living in Rheinberg at the time, word soon spread that an eligible young man had arrived in town. And yet, being timid, Lehmann failed to notice the glances sent his way as he walked down the street. That was until he met Helena Horn, the 22-year-old woman who lived a few doors down from him. It was Helena who picked out the shy, thin, scholarly man from Jever. It was Helena who invited him home for tea, who first kissed him and then encouraged him to do more. A few weeks later, and to the dismay of some, in particular Lehmann's mother, Helena announced that she was pregnant. Though premarital sex was fairly commonplace within the wider population, it would have been scandalous for a Hebrew teacher to be the father of an illegitimate child, and, despite the fact that Lehmann could offer little in the way of financial security, a match was agreed. So it was that on the 21st of August 1819, the couple were married at the town hall on the main square. Now 5 months pregnant, Helena had a bump that was visible for all to see, including the four official witnesses, two merchants, a butcher and a neighbour, as well as the mayor of Rheinberg, who oversaw the ceremony. Perhaps offended that it was a shotgun wedding, Lehmann's parents did not attend. In contrast, when asked for her view of the nuptials, Helena's mother responded with uncommon enthusiasm, saying that she gave her complete consent. The license noted that while Lehmann was a teacher, Helena was illiterate and unemployed. The party then retired, as was traditional, to the bride's house on Rheinstrasse. As a violinist played, Helena and Lehmann were lifted aloft on chairs and paraded around the courtyard. While the mood was celebratory, talk soon turned to the anti-Jewish pogroms that had erupted 3 days earlier in the Bavarian town of Rimpon near Würzburg, 300 kilometres to the south of Rheinberg. The day's local newspaper reported that young men had run through the street armed with hatchets and crowbars, shouting, "Hep, hep," meaning the destruction of Jerusalem, and, "If you don't flee, then you are through." Vandals had then smashed the windows of four Jewish houses, broken into the Rimpon synagogue, and destroyed the sacred scrolls inside. Later that night, Lehmann reassured Helena that the riots would remain in the south. After all, the Jewish community had long been tolerated in the Rhineland, and besides, hadn't they just been married by the mayor himself? Still, as he lay awake, he worried about what would happen. He didn't have long to find out. The next day, the 22nd of August, a council edict was pinned to the wall of the public reading room in Düsseldorf, less than 50 kilometres from Rheinberg, ordering the expulsion of Jews from the city. Later that night, black arrows were painted on the houses of many Jews, and a notice nailed to the house of Rabbi Loeb Aaron Scheuer read, "The domination of Jews over the conduct of trade has already lasted too long. Christians have calmly observed this. Times have changed. If by the 26th of this month restrictions are not placed on this people, there will be a bloodbath." Over the next few weeks, Lehmann heard of violent pogroms moving ever closer. Bamberg, Heidelberg, Frankfurt. These attacks were the most recent expression of Judenschuld, the long-held view that Jews were to be blamed for everything. Such canards were fueled by fears that Jews had made financial gains during the Napoleonic Wars. Across western and northwestern Germany, Jewish homes and shops were looted. Jewish men were beaten with wooden batons and synagogues were set on fire. With few exceptions, priests, the military and local politicians stood by, doing nothing as the beatings continued. Still, despite the violent bloody threats in Düsseldorf, which were as yet unrealised, the left bank of the Rhine where Lehmann and Helena lived remained peaceful. Then, on the 12th of October 1819, at the end of the summer festival in the village of Dormagen, 50 kilometres and 1 day's ride south of Rheinberg, Stoffel Blömer, the local stonemason, noticed that his 7-year-old daughter, Maria Katharina, was missing. The child had gone with some others to a nearby village to tend a cow, came back and said to her mother, "I want to put on my best dress and go out and enjoy myself." The girl followed the music into the village, passed the church, and disappeared. Every house was searched, and people looked down wells and in the River Rhine. Nothing was found. This story was conveyed by word of mouth from one tradesperson to the next up the River Rhine, Uerdingen, Duisburg, and then on to Rheinberg. The events that followed were recorded by Johann Peter Delhofen in the Rheinische Dorfchronik, the Dormagen Village Chronicle. According to Delhofen, there were thousands of opinions being discussed as to what happened to the girl. The prevailing one is that the Jews captured the child because at times, according to an old legend, they must have Christian blood. And since the disappearance of the child coincides with the end of Sukkot, Feast of Tabernacles, there are all kinds of witnesses who claim to have seen either the Jew Zekel with a sack or the Jew Shimmel lurking around houses at midnight. Then, on the 17th of October, a local man, Matthias Heck, found the body of a child lying next to a willow tree in a wood outside Dormagen. It was Maria Katharina. She had been loosely bound twice around the neck, her body impaled to the ground. Her stockings had been pulled down, but not taken off. After examining the body later that evening, a local surgeon announced that the child had been raped. Johann Peter Delhofen noted that on hearing the shocking news, people came to Dormagen from as far as 3 hours away to demonstrate their outrage and their support for Maria Katharina's family. This culminated in a rowdy church service. On all sides, the rumor spread that the child's blood had been sucked and she had bled from 700 wounds, he wrote. I myself saw the child, her arms and legs covered in red spots, and I myself knew that the Jews were the perpetrators. This was, the chronicler alleged, a ritual mordlegende, or ritual murder myth, based on the ancient fallacy that Jews used Christian blood for their ceremonies. Over the next days, and despite the lack of any evidence to link the crime to a suspect, various Jewish community members were attacked. A teacher and a butcher were assaulted by children and young lads. One trader's windows were smashed, and another had a dead piglet laid at his door. A peddler had his doors smeared with muck and a side of bacon put in front of his house. On the 30th of October, the Jewish cemetery in Hülchrat, just south of Düsseldorf, was attacked and several gravestones were smashed. The next day, a Jewish school was attacked, its windows and blackboard broken. Two adults reported that they were badly abused as they left the school. No one could remember hearing of such violence since the Dark Ages. As he travelled the region giving Hebrew lessons, Lehmann read the reports of what had become known as the Hep Hep riots. The news, however, was not all bad. In many of the newspapers, he read editorials and letters denouncing the anti-Jewish violence. In others, writers suggested that persecuted Jews could come to their countries to find safe haven. The French-language paper La Renommée, for instance, published an impassioned column that autumn saying that the Jews of Germany should abandon an ungrateful soil where justice is refused them and come instead to France, where they can enjoy our fine climate, the benefits of law that guarantees the safety of person and property, the freedom of industry, opinions and consciences. Their change will occasion them no regret. From this and other entreaties, Lehmann understood there were places that would not only accept Jews like himself, but would welcome them. If life became unbearable in Rheinberg, which he still hoped would not be the case, then he and Helena would have to move and find somewhere more tolerant. Perhaps France, perhaps somewhere else. At noon on the 10th of December, a month after the riots had finally petered out, Helena gave birth to a daughter named Adelheid. Tragically, the infant died 2 weeks later. No cause was listed on the death certificate, which was registered at the town hall on the 16th of January 1820. They tried again, and on Thursday the 4th of January 1821, Helena gave birth to a boy, Samuel. Lehmann was not present for the birth. He was teaching in the nearby town of Goch. But he was very much present 8 days later for the Brit Mila, or circumcision. A second boy, Meyer, named after Lehmann's father, followed a year later, and then a third, Nathan, a year after that. Suddenly the Gluckstein house seemed small, with three boys all under the age of three, but they were content. Lehmann was busy with his teaching work, while Helena had her hands full with the children. Then, on the 13th of September 1824, 6 months after Nathan's birth, word arrived in Rheinberg that further restrictive laws had been passed in Berlin. The Prussian government now decreed not only that the protection fee cancelled under Napoleonic law was owed once again, but also that the amount that had accumulated over the previous 3 decades was due immediately. For those not rich enough to pay, the only ways out were bankruptcy, imprisonment, or death. To make matters worse, the new laws also declared that all Jewish religious teachers must apply to the authorities for a license, providing supporting documents demonstrating that the teacher had all the necessary certificates. Given that he was self-taught, Lehmann quickly realized that he would never be approved. Overnight, he lost his position, and another qualified Hebrew tutor was appointed in his place. Lehmann was now facing huge debts and was unable to support his young family. Thinking of the entreaties in foreign newspapers, the obvious option was to flee. But how to ensure there would be no retribution for Helena's mother and siblings? After all, according to the new Prussian laws, Lehmann owed the government a vast sum of money. The debt would stay, even if he didn't. Facing ruin, there appeared to be only one solution. 2 weeks later, gravediggers at the Rheinberg Cemetery gave a final tamp to the mounded earth and walked away, tools in hand. On the pale grey headstone were etched the following words: Gluckstein, Lehmann, 1787 to 1824, from Jever, teacher. Chapter 2, 1824. As the Glucksteins approached from the south, Arnhem rose impressively before them. 5 times bigger than Rheinberg, it was the largest town Helena had ever seen. Its church steeples, 3 in all, seemed taller and more imposing than those back home. Its ancient medieval stone bridge, which spanned the placid river, was wide and without a gatehouse. And, unlike Rheinberg, this city's walls had been torn down. This all came as quite a surprise to Helena, for, unlike her husband, she had never travelled more than a few kilometres from her birthplace. It had been a hard trek. For more than a week they had followed the River Rhine north of Rheinberg, dragging their meagre supplies on a wooden cart into the Netherlands until they reached the Arnhem town limits. The journey had been made harder by having to look after the 3 children. Harder still, for they were on the run, unsure if they were being chased, unsure if their ruse had been rumbled. For walking alongside Helena was her very much alive husband, Lehmann Meyer Gluckstein, who had faked his death to allow them to escape without saddling her family with repercussions. It had been a simple enough scheme to pull off. Record-keeping was unsophisticated at this point, and whilst the law called for all births, marriages and deaths to be registered at the local town hall, many were not. An infant who perished before reaching their first birthday, for instance, was rarely noted. Similarly, those who lived in remote rural areas often changed status without bureaucratic note. So it was that at the same time that his gravestone was being readied in the Rheinberg dirt, Lehmann was leading his family into the heart of the Netherlands in search of safer environs. Once they had found somewhere to spend the night, he went out in search of employment. Arnhem had a sizable Jewish community, vital for Lehmann's work, with a synagogue on Nieuwe Wolstraat, New Rampart Street, a cemetery, a Jewish school, and a society dedicated to the study of the Torah. Lehmann soon learned that the wealthier Jews were involved with the country's growing sugar import trade as bankers, clerks, and wholesalers. There was even a Jewish lawyer living in the town. Less affluent Jews worked as shopkeepers, salesmen, market labourers, and butchers. As such, and with a Jewish population of more than 400, 6 times that of Rheinberg, Arnhem was considered one of the most prosperous Jewish communities in the Netherlands. It didn't take long, therefore, for Lehmann to find a few families looking for help with their Hebrew lessons. As the months rolled by, his reputation for being a good teacher spread, and so his list of clients grew. Yet, despite his hard work, there never seemed quite enough income to pay the bills, and the family remained stuck in a constant state of financial jeopardy. The problem was that the people Lehmann worked with did not have much money themselves, and he found it hard to charge when they could ill afford it. When things got particularly tight, Lehmann would hustle around and find extra clients. He would work late into the evening, coming home exhausted, but with a few coins in his pockets. Elena, meanwhile, was pregnant once again. Her days were filled with the domestic chores of shopping, cooking and washing, while the boys, Samuel, Maya and Nathan, were all out of cloth nappies and running around the house causing mayhem. Activity came to a halt every Friday evening for the Shabbat, and this lasted until sunset the following day. This was a chance to attend synagogue, to better know the Jewish community, and to pray. Lehmann had always been a learned and curious man, someone who thought beyond the here and now. It may well have been due to the relative safety of their current situation, or an instinct that things would improve, that there would be a future when people, his children, their descendants, might be interested in his journey, that these times were important not just for him, but for others. And so, one evening, when the family was asleep, he began. He picked up the small leather-bound book that he had brought with him from Rheinberg. It was 200 years old, a lexicon of ancient Hebrew and Chaldean words written by the Swiss-born Johannes Buxtorf, the so-called master of rabbis. With one hand holding open its back pages, Lehmann picked up a quill with the other, dipped it in black ink, and began to write his first entry. The day of my birth, the 17th of July, 1794. Born in Jever, in the Duchy of Oldenburg, near Bremen, Lehmann Meyer Gluckstein, son of Meyer Lehmann Gluckstein and Adela Josef. He went on to record his wife's details, their marriage and information about their three sons, including German and Hebrew names, along with dates and place of birth. After his children's names, he wrote Mazel Tov, or With Good Fortune. He also added the portion of the Torah that was read out in synagogue the weeks of their birth. In addition, having studied the secret Kabbalah texts, Lehmann noted any numerological significance that he could find. His wedding, for instance, which took place during the Hebrew year of 5579, had the meaning of good and sweet, which appeared to please him. What he did not record, however, was the bad news. In February 1826, his wife gave birth to their fourth son, Josef, who died a few weeks later. A fifth son, Alexander, was born 2 years after that, and again he died soon after birth. Neither of these children were chronicled at the back of Lehmann's lexicon. Happily, over the next 3 years, three more children were born, all of whom survived: Zolly, Harry, and Berta. The last was named after Helena's mother. Her Hebrew name, Bincha, meant dear little bee. With six small children to feed, Lehmann set about writing a book, hoping that sales might supplement the income he made from giving Hebrew lessons. Over the summer and winter of 1831, he spent long hours in his study, working and reworking the text. Finally, in early 1832, he delivered the manuscript to the publisher C.A. Timer. It was 45 pages long, written in Flemish, and called A Simple and Sure Guide to Learn the Gender of French Substantives in 10 Rules. In his introduction, Lehmann, who now called himself a language teacher, wrote that he hoped his method would make French more comprehensible to Dutch youth, a method which, as far as I know, no other work has used. The book was well received, with one critic in the educational magazine Tijdschrift für Onderwijzers recommending it greatly. A simple and sure guide, the reviewer wrote, can prove helpful to simplify the teaching of French language. But while it was a critical success, the book made little difference to the family coffers. Fewer copies sold than had been hoped, and the writing had taken much more time than Lehmann had expected, reducing the number of lessons he could provide and worsening the family finances. It was clear to Helena that Arnhem could not fix their pecuniary woes. She had heard that the Jewish merchants working in the port cities were affluent, for international trade was flourishing. They would pay better, she told Lehmann. The solution was to move again westwards. In the spring of 1832, the Glucksteins arrived in the city of Rotterdam. It was quite a shock. Unlike Arnhem, the streets teemed with wagons and drays clattering goods to and from the wholesalers and auction houses on the wharves and docks. Hawkers stood in droves, calling out their products. Men in tailored suits and women in beautifully designed dresses were carried past in an assortment of horses and carts. The luxurious four-wheeled barouche, the sedate landau, the speedy phaeton. Government workers attempted to maintain order, shouting instructions and directing traffic. It was organized chaos. For the family from the small town of Rheinberg, Germany, it was all, the noise, the people, the busyness, overwhelming. They had chosen Rotterdam for two reasons. It was a port city, making it likely to be commercially busy and therefore hopefully affluent. Secondly, it was home to more than 2,500 Jews, making it the largest Jewish community in the Netherlands outside Amsterdam. In fact, Rotterdam had as many Jews as there were residents of Rheinberg. The Glücksteins made their way to the Jewish quarter, which was centered around the old synagogue in De Bumpjes, a neighborhood abutting the harbor and known for its avenue of lime trees. But when they arrived and had found somewhere to stay, Lehmann and Helena were disappointed to learn that there was no shortage of Hebrew teachers. Worse, there wasn't much need for Lehmann's linguistic skills. The streets and bars were brimming with out-of-work translators and polyglots. Over the next few days, the family discussed various options. They could wait for a job opening. This seemed unwise, given what they had already learned. They could move on to another town, but they were exhausted by travel. Finally, Lehmann could reinvent himself and try something entirely new. But what? During his visits to taverns and marketplaces across the lowlands, Lehmann had noticed the public's increasing interest in foreign affairs. There was certainly much to discuss. In the two preceding years alone, Belgium and Greece had won their independence. William IV had ascended to the English throne, whilst Charles X of France had abdicated in favour of his grandson Louis-Philippe. There was a new pope in Rome. Meanwhile, François Arban had achieved the world's first ever ascent in a hot air balloon. Lehmann had also noted the popularity of street-side entertainments in the larger towns and cities. Jugglers and violinists, performing animals and camera obscuras. It was this last that had caught his eye. What if it was possible to combine people's interest in public events with some new way to present them? During the summer of 1832, Lehmann sat at home and experimented. Having purchased a number of small lenses from an optician, he tried out different arrangements. A watercolour picture illuminated by candlelight, natural light shining through a glass, a hole in a curtain projecting on a wall. The task required great dexterity and patience. He was helped by his 11-year-old son Samuel, whose small and nimble hands were better suited to manipulating the delicate objects, and who showed such enthusiasm that Lehmann soon viewed him as indispensable to the enterprise's success. Father and son eventually settled on a device that consisted of a portable wooden viewing box through which coloured painted cards were magnified and illuminated. The illustrations were placed at the back of the box, which was then held up to the light and viewed through a glass lens. Most cards included small cut-out parts through which the light would pass, depicting windows or street lamps, and thus the scene appeared to be illuminated by these light sources. Some cards were also designed to change, so that a scene might appear to alter, for example, from a daytime to a nighttime view. They called this device the polyrama panoptique. In one of their first outings, Zam and Lehmann erected a tent next to the harbour wall in Rotterdam. The experiment proved a great success, and before long, father and son were taking the attraction around the Netherlands. First, they set up on the Visbrug, or fishing bridge, in the centre of Leiden, and invited passers-by to take a view into their magical machine, for a price, of course. They moved on to The Hague, Delft, and Utrecht. To promote their project, they took out advertisements in the newspapers. In Amsterdam, for instance, they paid for an entry in the Algemeen Handelsblatt, proclaiming that their camera had previously found the greatest fame and praise in cities across the country. For those interested in enjoying the marvel, it continued, The Glucksteins would be exhibiting just across from the French theatre. Over the next decade, Lehmann and Samuel crisscrossed the Netherlands and Belgium. In each city or town, they found a good location with plenty of traffic, set up the machine, drummed up interest, took in the coins, and settled the accounts at the day's end. After a day or two, once they had tapped the local interest, they moved on to the next town. Lehmann was used to the constant travel, but found the endless hawking and peddling tiring. Samuel, by contrast, was a natural salesperson who enjoyed the unpredictability of the road, and so they continued. As the years progressed, they learned the basics of trade, providing quality products that consumers wanted, sold at affordable prices, with patience and, perhaps most important of all, showmanship. The Glucksteins' wondrous contraption was soon talked about in the highest of circles. Indeed, during a stop in The Hague, they were even visited by members of the Dutch royal family. Their most popular picture was that of Napoleon's funeral in 1840. The Polyrama captured the moment after the great man's remains had been controversially returned from his prison on the island of St. Helena, interred in an oak coffin wrapped in the French tricolour and placed upon an enormous iron-berthed carriage, then paraded with great ceremony and colour before an enormous crowd along the resplendent Champs-Élysées in Paris. To some of the Low Countries denizens who put their eye to the lightbox, Napoleon was a fiend, an occupier and dictator. To others, including Lehmann and Samuel, Bonaparte was a liberator, a moderniser and a friend to religious minorities. Either way, he was a larger-than-life character and, most importantly, he was good for business. It was during this time of commercial experimentation that the family was hit by a double tragedy. Helena gave birth for the 9th time, but the little baby girl, whom they called Hester, died less than a month later. Then, on the 11th of April 1841, their son Gershom died at the age of 4 years and 10 months. Lehmann now took out his precious book and, with an uneven hand, scratched out his son's name and information over and over again until the writing was barely legible. As the family attempted to come to terms with their loss, another worry loomed large. Holland's economy had weakened significantly over the past few years, with GDP per capita falling from 1.3% in the 1830s to 0.4% in the early 1840s. Salaries were not keeping up with price increases, hitting poorer families such as the Glucksteins particularly hard. Despite their proven charms, Lehmann and Samuel were finding it harder to persuade people to part with their money. As fewer crowds were drawn to the Polyrama Panoptique, they felt more pressure to deliver the funds necessary to make ends meet. And it was then that Samuel, who was now 20 years old, got into trouble. Late in 1841, in an attempt to turn the family's fortunes around, Samuel sold some items that were of dubious quality. Unhappy with the deal, the purchaser accused him of fraud and went to the police. Samuel told his parents that he was innocent of any wrongdoing and was being made a scapegoat because of his religion. Realizing they were unlikely to receive a fair hearing, the Glucksteins hurriedly relocated to Antwerp in Belgium. In early August 1842, Lehmann wrote to the authorities in Antwerp asking for a residency permit for Samuel. This was forwarded to the government offices in the capital, Brussels, along with a report from the Antwerp chief of police, which recorded that Samuel was convicted for fraud in the Netherlands but escaped by taking flight. The following day, the 18th of August 1842, the Minister of Justice in Brussels replied to the Mayor of Antwerp. Concerning S. Glucksteyn, who lives with his father, Glucksteyn, master of foreign languages, it began, I ask you not to lose sight of him. This foreigner seems to be obliged to leave Holland after being involved in a swindle. On the 2nd of November, the Antwerp chief of police wrote to the city's mayor saying that Lehmann Gluckstein has shown very good character and is arranging his son's affairs, adding that it can be painful for parents when they are torn from a child who had made some youthful mistakes, which are anyway easy to rectify. 2 weeks later, the administrator of the Ministry of Justice approved the residency permit for Samuel Gluckstein, without an umlaut. Despite the official approval, there was now a black mark against Samuel, and it was clear that the authorities were keeping an eye on him. Over the winter months, which were memorable for their mild temperatures, lack of rain, and the continuing decline in business revenues, the family again had to consider their future. Should Samuel try and clear his name? Should the entire clan relocate? Finally, they made a decision. Samuel would journey to London, where it was said the economy was booming and religious tolerance was assured. Then, on the 9th of February 1843, shortly before Samuel's departure, Helena gave birth to Benjamin, the traditional Jewish name for the youngest child. The family had grown to 9. Lehmann, Helena, Samuel, and his 6 younger siblings. Samuel would act as the family's vanguard. Once he had established himself, he would send for the others. Chapter 3, 1843. As the Lord Melville pushed its way up the River Thames, the 22-year-old Samuel Gluckstein stood on deck and marvelled at the relentless industrial activity and the chaotic skyline of wharves, warehouses and tenement buildings that formed the east end of London. It had been almost 20 years since he had left Rheinberg. He had spent most of the intervening time moving from one sleepy Dutch or Belgian city to the next. As for the town of his birth, he could remember little of it. What he could recall was the fear in his father's eyes and his longing for escape, for safe harbour. In Samuel's view, his father was wrong. They had never been safe in Germany or the Netherlands or Belgium, not under Napoleon or the Prussians or the Dutch king. Why should England be any different? There wasn't some magical city or town that would guarantee their well-being and accept their kind. Such a place didn't exist. At least, not yet. What they needed was improved social position, education, contacts, clout. And the only way to obtain all these was through money. This was Samuel's sole ambition, and he was committed to realizing it by any means necessary. He and the other passengers had boarded the schooner 8 hours earlier in the Belgian port of Ostend, leaving early to catch the morning tide. Given that it was summertime, the sea had been mercifully calm, the journey uneventful. Now they were in England, and his future lay before him, a chance to start afresh and, hopefully, make his family proud. Once the Lord Melville was tied off by the port hands, Samuel disembarked down a narrow wooden stairway and into the frenzied hubbub of London's premier port. Stevedores and dockers loading and unloading tea, sugar and timber, seamen, lightermen, ballast men and coal heavers preparing for the next voyage, casual workers waiting for the next call-on, prostitutes hoping to turn a mid-afternoon trick, and food sellers providing lukewarm tea and stale refreshments to those working in the port. At the customs building, Samuel joined the schooner's other passengers, suitcase in hand, as he waited to be processed by a port official. When it was their turn, the master of the Lord Melville handed over a 1-page list of aliens that included the names of 29 passengers, of whom 13 came from Germany, 5 from Belgium, and the rest from France, Norway, and Poland. There were no passports to be reviewed, no medical records to be examined, and no assets to be enumerated. Having glanced at the form, the official signed his name and added the date of entry, the 21st of August, 1843. Once clear of customs, Samuel asked one of his fellow passengers where he could find lodgings for the night. There were boarding houses in Whitechapel, he was told. It was a short walk from the port of London, and they took in newly arrived immigrants such as him. Samuel headed towards the district known as Whitechapel. A century before, it had been a peaceful, industrious suburb, where breweries, tanneries and slaughterhouses sat cheek by jowl with traveller inns and public houses. In the past few decades, the neighbourhood had become a melting pot of immigrants from Ireland and Germany, Poland and the Netherlands. Its maze of narrow streets had been transformed into an overcrowded district rife with poverty and delinquency, Half the houses had only basic sewage drainage. The rest had none, emptying their waste into cesspools whose foul odour polluted the air and poisoned the water of nearby public pumps. Cholera, smallpox, scarlet fever and whooping cough were endemic. In 1843, the death rate in Whitechapel was 21% higher than in the rest of London. At this time, Whitechapel was fast becoming a Jewish ghetto. Of the capital's 25,000 Jews, the vast majority resided in the East End, making up more than 50% of England's total Jewish population. Living close to each other enabled them to communicate easily, typically in Yiddish, share religious ceremonies, intermarry, and do business together. Most of the Jewish families worked as merchants, including those trading in jewels, old clothes, leather, picture frames, toys, antiques, and cigars. The majority faced profound economic hardship. By mid-century, 25 to 30% of Jews in London were receiving poor relief, and half were impoverished or scarcely making a living. With poverty came crime. Whitechapel was known as a haven for pickpockets and prostitution, prize-fighting and gambling, opium dens and card cheats. This was the domain of colourful characters such as the fence Ikey Solomon, supposedly the basis for Fagin in Dickens' novel Oliver Twist, a place where people of quality, such as Oscar Wilde's Dorian Gray, visited the entertainments only to return to civilised London when their fun was over. Above all, Whitechapel was infamous for its moneylenders, its men with sharp wits, and its thugs, all of whom Samuel was keen to avoid. Finally, as in the rest of Europe, London was also home to virulent anti-Jewish sentiment, so living close to other Jews in Whitechapel provided a form of safety in numbers. Later that evening, Samuel saw a sign announcing a room for rent in a tall, overcrowded boarding house at 9 Freeman Street in Whitechapel. Although he was fluent in German and Dutch, Samuel spoke little English. Luckily, the building's manager, Conrad Joseph, was also from Holland. Samuel was able to communicate that he had just landed in the capital, would be starting up a new business, and needed accommodation until such time as he could afford a larger place. As long as he paid on time, Joseph said, the room was his. As the centre of the ever-expanding British Empire, London in August 1843 was booming. Over the past 8 months, the acclaimed engineer Isambard Kingdom Brunel had opened the first tunnel under the River Thames. The Bombay Army had won the Battle of Hyderabad, securing the massive Sindh province for the East India Company at a cost of 2,000 Talpur troops killed. Natal province, almost 100,000 square kilometres of land in the southernmost tip of Africa, was taken from the Boers and proclaimed a British colony. The country was undergoing railway mania, with thousands of kilometres of new line being constructed, and the volume of its stock exchange trade rose ever upwards, driven partly by Britain's monopoly of the telegraph, which transmitted the latest news from around the world via ticker tape. Meanwhile, Britain was simultaneously experiencing a cultural renaissance and mounting self-confidence. Theatres had been liberalised by eliminating the royal patent, and the free press was flourishing, especially compared to the continent. The Times described Germany's press that year as existing under the thraldom not only of the censorship, but of absolute and ruinous prohibitions. At the same time, sympathy for the monarch was at an all-time high after three assassins over the previous 12 months had tried and failed to kill the young Queen Victoria. The week Samuel set foot in the docks of East London happened to coincide with the launch of The Economist, a newspaper set up to promote economic liberalism. "We seriously believe that free trade, free intercourse, will do more than any other visible agent," proclaimed its prospectus the previous month, "to extend civilization and morality throughout the world, yes, to extinguish slavery itself." In the newspaper's first edition, published on the 2nd of September 1843, the editorial board noted that commercial matters have assumed a more cheerful aspect in every quarter, and that the demand for almost every description of foreign and colonial produce has been on a decidedly improved scale. The home markets for wool, iron, money and corn, they reported in their already dry but exact tone, were all up. A different perspective was offered by Friedrich Engels, who at the time was working in his father's textile factory some 320 kilometres to the north in Manchester. 8 months before Samuel's arrival in London, Engels wrote an article for the Rheinische Zeitung describing England as feudal and up to its neck in the Middle Ages. For while industry had made the country rich, it had also created a class of unpropertied, absolutely poor people, a class which lives from hand to mouth, which multiplies rapidly, and which afterwards cannot be abolished because it can never acquire stable possession of property. Engels was recounting the situation of many of Samuel's new East End neighbours. Combining the viewpoints of the economist and Engels, it appeared that for a young immigrant, 1840s Britain could either be a land of opportunity and promise, or a place of never-ending toil and conflict. The outcome would probably be down to hard work, personality, and not a little luck. On his entry documents, Samuel had stated that he was a merchant. He had reported the same to the Antwerp authorities the previous year. What he hadn't disclosed was his interest in tobacco. Like his father, Samuel had long enjoyed smoking. During his various travels around Holland, he had become acquainted with many cigar makers and visited their small workshops. Observant and curious, he had picked up the basics of the manufacturing process. He now launched himself into his new career. First, he purchased a small quantity of dried leaf direct from the warehouses in the West India docks. Back in his little room in Whitechapel, he attempted to make the cigars. It was frustrating work, harder than it looked, requiring great dexterity and timing. Pack the tobacco too tight and the flame went out. Pack it too loose and the burn was uneven. Roll it too quickly and the cigar looked ugly or worse, fell apart. Use the wrong leaf and the cigar would char and emit a foul-smelling odour. The aim was a cigar that looked attractive, tasted good, and burned with a clear, steady light, leaving a fine white or pearl-coloured ash. Samuel rolled cigar after cigar after cigar. It was tedious, painstaking, and exhausting work. He kept practicing, working long into the night, learning by trial and error, until one day he collapsed and crawled into bed. He had picked up an infection and developed a high fever. Without any family to look after him, he lay alone in his small room, unable to feed himself. At the year's end, the medical officer for Whitechapel would report that 2,083 residents had died from fever. He was fortunate, therefore, that Anne Joseph, the building manager's 24-year-old daughter, was walking past his door and heard Samuel's calls for help. She brought him water and, when he felt better, clear soup. Sitting in a chair next to his bed, she asked about his family and told him about hers. She had arrived with her parents and brother from Holland 13 years earlier. Like Samuel, they were Jewish and kept kosher at home. Her father had been found guilty of stealing lottery tickets in Amsterdam. Of course he was innocent, she said, and had been sentenced to 18 months in prison. He had appealed, but just before the hearing, they had fled to England. Lying on his bed, looking at this kind, patient woman, Samuel wondered if he was not the only one to have been falsely accused. Under Anne's careful attention, he soon recovered fully and redoubled his business efforts. After finally filling a box with reasonable-looking cigars, he went out onto the street and tried to sell them. Deploying the techniques he had learned when promoting the Panorama at the harbourside in Rotterdam and at the fishing bridge in Leiden, he was able to sell one cigar and then another. Soon he was selling enough to pay the rent and then to afford three meals a day. Then enough for a bunch of roses for Anne and a new suit. On Sunday the 25th of May 1845, 2 years after Samuel set foot in England, he walked with Anne to the local town hall in Whitechapel. The wedding would be a small affair, as Samuel's parents and siblings were yet to arrive from Holland. On the marriage certificate, the registrar added their names and dates of birth and wrote that Zamuel's father was a minister and Anne's was a shoemaker. Zamuel then signed his name and Anne added a mark in the shape of an egg. Like his mother, when she had wed back in Rheinberg, Zamuel's bride was illiterate. Zamuel and Anne set about making a home for themselves. They moved into a two-room flat in a run-down building at number 34 Whitechapel High Street, a busy main road just a couple of streets away from Anne's parents. Shortly afterwards, Anne announced that she was pregnant. Zamuel was delighted. With a child on the way, he and Anne worked hard to increase the cigar business. With two of them now buying, rolling and selling, profits soon rose. As they moved into winter, Anne's belly swelled, but she kept working. By the year's end, she grew tired more quickly, finding it hard to keep up with her husband's long hours. Compared to other pregnant women, her stomach seemed larger, but she was healthy, and for this she was grateful. On the 15th of February 1846, almost exactly 9 months after the wedding, Anne went into labour. She was at home, and at 5:30 in the afternoon, she gave birth to a girl. They called her Lena, after Zamuel's mother. A few minutes later, and to their great surprise, a second girl was born, a twin, whom they named Julia. These were the family's first British-born grandchildren. When Zamuel and Anne registered the birth certificates at the town hall, they omitted the umlaut from the girl's last name. They would now be known by the anglicised form of Gluckstein. Zamuel sent word to his parents in Antwerp. They had two grandchildren and the business was looking good. It was time to come to England. Almost exactly a year later, Zamuel's parents and four youngest siblings arrived at the port of London. His two eldest brothers, Nathan and Maya, remained in Belgium. After clearing customs, the newcomers walked to Whitechapel and soon were at Zamuel and Anne's home. Now, across the crowded kitchen table, a rich mixture of Dutch, German, Yiddish and Cockney English was exchanged. Within a few days, however, it became clear there was just not enough room for all of them. After a quick search, Zamuel helped his father find a flat at 14 Castle Place, just a few minutes' walk from 34 Whitechapel High Street. Zamuel paid for the first month's rent with the savings they had built up over the last few months. It was a diverse area. Half of their neighbours were born in England, while the others were from Central and Western Europe. They included a fishmonger, five cap makers, four tailors, two butchers, a needlewoman, a cane maker, a sack maker, a furrier, and a customs house officer. A quarter of the women and half the children aged 7 to 14 were registered as being in paid employment. Many of the residents spoke Yiddish, which was useful, as Zamuel's parents and siblings could not speak more than a few words of English. Once they were settled, three of Zamuel's siblings came to work for him. His younger brothers Zolly, 14, and Harry, 12, and his sister Bertha, 12. Zamuel's mother Helena remained at home looking after little Benjamin. His 60-year-old father, Lehmann, was now too old to toil in a workshop, so he also remained at home, improving his English and studying Hebrew texts. The task of manufacturing cigars could now be divided. Each morning, the siblings walked over to Zamuel and Anne's flat, which doubled up as a workshop. After a brief tutorial, and having practiced and mastered the craft, they were soon able to take over the time-consuming tasks of wrapping and rolling. The greater number of employees resulted in a dramatic rise in production levels and an increase in sales. This, in turn, liberated greater profits, which allowed for a sharp increase in the purchase of raw materials. Zamuel spent much of his time at the London auction house, sampling, negotiating, and purchasing tobacco leaf. In particular, tobacco leaf that had just arrived from Virginia. Chapter 4, 1847. The origin of Virginia tobacco can be traced back to 240 years earlier. In the final weeks of 1606, a group of 200 settlers set sail from Plymouth in southwest England, heading for the New World. consisting of three ships under the command of Captain Christopher Newport, the flotilla arrived 5 months later on the coast of what became known as Virginia. There, in the middle of May 1607, they erected a small number of dwellings along the banks of the Powhatan River. The new beginning was not an easy one. Within 3 years, after being ravaged by disease and starvation, only 60 of the original settlers had survived. The community was abandoned until June 1610, when a relief fleet arrived and Jamestown became Britain's first permanent settlement in the Americas. 4 years later, one of the settlers named John Rolfe, who had married Pocahontas, the daughter of a local chief, planted some tobacco seeds that he had picked up in Bermuda. 3 years after that, 50 Africans were delivered to Jamestown from a Portuguese slaving ship that had been captured in the West Indies and were set to work in the tobacco fields. The crop was successful, and soon Rolfe was sending the harvest back to England. Wishing to support the nascent colony's fragile economy, but disliking the foul-smelling weed, King James I had outlawed tobacco cultivation in England, and then, to garner income for the royal coffers, declared all imports to be under royal warrant and taxable. This monopoly continued into the mid-19th century, so that unlike its European neighbours, France, Germany and Austria, which grew much of their own tobacco, England sold tobacco in the London auction houses that was sourced almost entirely from Virginia. It also meant that for the next few centuries, the vast majority of tobacco products sold in London, including those of Samuel Gluckstein, could be traced to plantations worked by slaves. By the time of Samuel's arrival in London in 1843, the issue of slavery had been highly controversial for many decades. The first concerted British effort to abolish slavery was launched by a Quaker anti-slavery committee in the 1780s. Yet it was not until 1807 that the slave trade was prohibited within the British Empire, and not until 1833 that the House of Commons outlawed the ownership of slaves in Britain. There was, however, no prohibition on importing goods made by slaves overseas. It would be another 30 years before slavery was abolished in the USA, following the American Civil War of 1861 to 1865. Like other bulk buyers, Samuel Gluckstein was well aware that the tobacco he purchased was produced on the back of slave labour. During the great abolition debates of the 1830s and 1840s, most of the main newspapers ran stories on how tobacco was produced in the USA, along with details of the terrible conditions in which the slaves worked. Indeed, the most prudent and eagle-eyed traders, such as Samuel, prided themselves on knowing the names of the best plantation owners and their agents, as well as the optimal time of year to purchase the harvest. In particular, they knew the details of the Virginia tobacco crop cycle. Work began in early winter, with the male slaves felling any trees that grew on the land with a poleaxe, while the female slaves grubbed the undergrowth with a mattock and, together with their children, burned the brushwood and roots to clear the ground. In the new year, the slaves hoed the large clumps of earth into finer dirt and, if necessary, added Peruvian guano, then tilled once again. With the start of the rains in early spring, and if the land was considered ready by the overseer, the slaves, who were organized into gangs, then walked up and down the rows, scattering fine tobacco seeds from the baskets they carried on their arms. Next came months of weeding, transplanting, worming, hilling up, mounding earth around the stalk to protect the roots, topping, pinching the top of the stalk to prevent flowering, and suckering, removing new shoots. Then, when the sun was at its fiercest and the leaves had thickened and developed yellow spots, came the harvest. Early in the morning before the arrival of the dew, or late in the evening before the frost had set, the slaves walked up and down the rows, carefully cutting the now ripened but brittle plants, which were dangled over a 1.5-metre-long wooden pole. Once loaded with 7 to 9 plants, the poles were carried into the tobacco house and suspended from the roof for drying. Over the next few weeks, small coal fires were maintained within the shed to smoke the tobacco. The purpose of the curing process was to reduce the bitter-tasting chlorophyll and to darken the leaves to a pleasing colour. When cured, The leaves were stripped of their stalk, then separated by quality, before being prized into enormous hogshead barrels, each containing more than 500 kilograms of product. These were conveyed by horse and cart to Jamestown, Virginia, where they were loaded onto ships and transported to England. It was a never-ending process of brutal, back-breaking and soul-numbing work. Worse, the laws of Virginia afforded the slaves almost no protection from abuse. When mistakes were made, or the effort was considered inadequate, slaves endured terrible assaults, including whipping, branding, being half-hanged, raped and locked into a tobacco house filled with smoke. By the middle of the century, the black population of Virginia amounted to 500,000, of which fewer than 11% were free. The vast majority worked on the cotton and tobacco plantations. Through their efforts, more than 20,000 tons of slave-produced tobacco were shipped annually from Virginia to England. In taking economic advantage of overseas slaves, the Glucksteins were very much of their time. The Tate sugar family, for instance, continued to rely on cane products imported from the slave plantations of the Caribbean. Importers of Cuban cigars, such as Hunter's and Frankau and Robert Lewis, must have known that their much-prized Havanas were cultivated by slave labor. Indeed, the Glucksteins were so unperturbed, or perhaps unmindful of this issue, that as the 1840s moved into the 1850s, and their cigar manufacture increased, they accelerated their purchase of Virginia leaf. By 1853, the cigar-making business had outgrown Zamuel's home in Whitechapel and had moved into a workshop at 35 Crown Street off Charing Cross Road in Soho. Meanwhile, the clan continued to expand. In addition to their 7-year-old twins, Lena and Julia, who were inseparable, Zamuel and Anne now had 4 other children: Bertha, Catherine, Izzy, and Monty. Zamuel's sister, Bertha, had married local boy Lawrence Abrahams, who had also joined the business. Despite the increasing number of mouths to feed, the family was starting to display the beginnings of wealth. Zamuel was now able to pay for a 30-year-old servant from Ireland named Helena Dennett to help his aging parents. In return for her services, she received a small wage, along with free room and board, at Lehmann and Helena's home on Castle Place. The constant drumbeat of positive news did not last, though. In the autumn of 1854, Zamuel's 56-year-old mother, Helena, developed an infected boil known as a carbuncle. Such things were common in the dirt and grime of the East End, where it was a struggle to maintain hygiene. Despite repeated lancing and cleaning, the boil developed into a painful, pus-filled abscess under the skin. Over the next few days, the infection quickly spread to Helena's kidneys and other organs. Although she was in excruciating agony, there was little to be done. Finally, on the 6th of October, with Lehmann at her side, she died at home. Her death did not come as a surprise. Helena had given birth 12 times, had lost 4 children, had lived in more than 10 cities across 4 countries, and her health had been deteriorating for some time. Since her arrival in London, her well-being had only worsened, for, unlike her husband, she did not pick up languages easily and found navigating Whitechapel's tumult exhausting. Helena had served as the bedrock to the family. In addition to playing the homemaker, in which she had looked after the children, made meals and done the cleaning, she had guided Lehmann in moments of crisis, as well as moments of opportunity. Now, her labours were over. After making sure that his dear wife's eyes were shut, and having uttered a short prayer, Lehmann covered her with a sheet. He then sent for his eldest son, remaining at his wife's bedside himself, for, according to Jewish tradition, a corpse should never be left unattended. When Zamuel arrived, father and son spent a few moments sharing condolences before moving on to logistics. As a man steeped in Jewish practice, as well as being a Hebrew scholar, Lehmann well knew that the deceased should be buried quickly, typically within 24 hours of death, though not during a holiday period. As this was the day before the autumn celebration of Sukkot, Helena must therefore be interred before sunset. That gave them less than 9 hours.
Zamel immediately sent two of his younger brothers off into the neighbourhood, one to inform family and friends who might want to attend the burial, and the other to notify the rabbi. Meanwhile, Lawrence Abrahams, Samuel's brother-in-law, was sent to register the death at the town hall on Cannon Street. The problem was that Lawrence was illiterate. He added a cross instead of a signature. As a result, the name given for the woman born Helena Horn in Rheinberg and known by her family as Helena Gluckstein was recorded by the British authorities as Leander Gluckstein. An hour later, two men arrived at Castle Place from the Volunteer Burial Society. They carefully moved the body into a simple wooden coffin and transported it by horse and cart to the cemetery in Hackney. There, inside a red brick mortuary hall, they were greeted by three women who watched as the body was gently laid on a table. The men were then ushered out of the room, for it was time for tahara, the ritual washing of the body. First, the women lit candles near Helena's head, and then, having uttered a short prayer, "And I will sprinkle pure water upon you, and you shall be cleansed of all your filth and idols," they set about removing her clothes. As they worked, they treated the body with great care and respect, for, in addition to their love for Helena, they had been taught that the soul lingers for a short while after death. Methodically and in silence, they walked around the body, never reaching a cross, uncovering and washing only a small section at a time. Finally, once the purification was complete, they wrapped Helena in a simple white shroud, without shoes or headscarf, and then sat down next to the corpse. Outside the hall, the men stood guard, wooden staffs in hand, to ensure that nobody stole the body. For this was a time when a corpse could be sold to a doctor in return for sufficient money to feed a family for a month. Back in Whitechapel, now dressed in their best dark suits and hats, Lehmann and four of his sons, Samuel, Zolly, Harry and Benjamin, along with Lawrence Abrahams, walked out of the flat and onto the street. They were joined by neighbours and friends who greeted them in Yiddish with the customary sayings, "I wish you a long life" and "You should have no more distress." Once it was clear that nobody else was coming, Lehmann said it was time to go and led the crowd up the busy high street. It was a 50-minute walk, past the orderlies and porters beavering about outside the London hospital, through the mayhem of the Bethnal Green markets, along the Drive, a windy road that circumnavigated Victoria Park, and finally onto Grove Street in Hackney. Here they turned right into the cemetery, an unkempt and gloomy spot, half filled with disorderly sandstone headstones and chest tombs overgrown with ivy. Inside the mortuary hall, they were met by Rabbi H.L. Harris, who was standing next to Helena's coffin, her feet pointed towards her grave. When everyone had assembled, the rabbi began reciting a prayer and then a psalm, during which Samuel and his siblings ripped the left side of their shirts in a ritual sign of the grief they dearly felt. After a short eulogy, the body was lifted onto a bier.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.